حسينا حسينا وحسينا.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث. صدق الله العلي العظيم. Enlighten your majalis with the salat of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala
Normally, any newborn that is born to a family, basically he is born to a family with parents, the father and the mother. And although it is God, the Almighty God is the one who sustains him and provides for him and send him or send her the sustenance and nourishment, yet it is the parents who are considered to be the forefront cause or means by which this child is getting raised and receiving those nourishments. It is the parents who provide for the children. It is the parents who take care of their needs, and it is the parents who take them away from the harm and provide for them, raise them, give them medical attention and raise them to become a successful, sound and reasonable adult in society. Now, some of those children are unfortunate to lose their parents during their childhood, during their early years when they are developing. To those kind of children, it is called orphans. So, by definition, an orphan is the one who loses either one or both of his parents due to death in his minor years, as he's about to grow. Our topic tonight will be about the society's care for the orphans and how it should be. After your salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
In the Islamic ruling or the Islamic religious terms, an orphan is someone who has lost his father during the early ages, meaning when he is a minor child before reaching the age of maturity. When his father passes away, that person, that child is considered to be an orphan. From a psychological point of view, an orphan is someone who lacks the emotional support and protection. You see, there are many supports that we need in order to develop in a full maturity. For a child to be sound and reasonable adult in his early lives, he needs to receive certain supports. The first support is the biological support, through which adequate amount of food with good quality of nourishment should be received in order for this child to biologically grow and develop. Another kind of support is the medical support or the health-related support. Whenever this child gets sick, there should be a medical attention for it. He should be cured for the diseases. He should be taken care of in terms of the immunization, should be receiving the immunizations regularly. And any issue that is pertaining to his health should be addressed while in his developing years. Of course, in addition to that, it is the shelter that is provided for him to protect him from heat, from coldness, and so forth. This is called the medical support. And most importantly, it is the emotional support, the psychological and emotional support that a child should receive in order to grow and become a normal adult. That support is the one that is an orphan lacks. Of course, the orphan lacks probably all of those, but the other two could be somehow replenished, could be, you know, found an alternative for those. But the important one is the lack of emotional support. It is that support that causes an orphan to be deprived and become, you know, in deficiency and not be able to combat, to compete with the rest of the children. For this particular important point, that he receives less of the emotional support. When you look at the ayat, for example, in the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talks about the orphans, in some points he criticizes the society for not giving adequate support for that orphan. He does not talk about the nourishment or the money that to be paid to the orphan. Rather, he says, كَلَّا بَلَّا تُكْرِمُونَ الْيَتِيمِ وَلَا تَحَاضُّونَ عَلَىٰ طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينَ. Oh, you people do not care about the dignity of an orphan. You do not honor the orphan. Rather, the orphan, of course, needs nourishment, needs food, needs money to spend. But Quran does not emphasize on this point. Rather, emphasizes on the point which is very important to any human being, and that is the emotional support. It is through this emotional support that a child receives and builds his integrity and dignity. It is through this support that he receives love, cherish, tenderness, and compassion, and then he becomes a social person. It is through this support, which is provided by the parents, that gives him education and good quality of life. If that support does not exist, then you will see that this individual, this particular individual, is lacking, cannot compete with others. It has just become a robot. Therefore, you see, Quran has emphasized on this fact. There is another poet, it's an Arab poet, who has described the orphan in this beautiful way. He says that an orphan is not the one who has lacked his parents, that parents are dead, and he has become orphan and lost his parent in early age. No, the orphan is that person whom, if you look, you see that his mother is careless about him and his father is too busy for him. That poet is called Ahmed Shawqi. He says, لَيْسَ الْيَتِيمُ مَنْ انْتَهَى أَبَوَاهُ مِنْ هَمِّ الْحَيَاةُ وَخَلَّفَاهُ ذَلِيلًا. The orphan is not that guy whose parent has lost, who died, who perished, and left him to be humiliated in society. No, that is not the orphan. The orphan is, إِنَّ الْيَتِيمُ هُوَ الَّذِي تَلْقَى لَهُ
أُمَّنْ تَخَلَّتْ أَوْ أَبًا مَجْغُولًا. That orphan is the one whom, if you look, you see that his mother is always busy, does not pay attention, enough attention to his care, nor his father is caring about him. This is the most important point, brothers and sisters. Not only for the orphans, for those people, for those children who have parents. Unfortunately, nowadays, especially in an industrialized and modern country like the U.S., when the father gets up in the early morning and goes to work, and most likely the mother also is involved in some sort of work, this child, from the time that he wakes up in the early morning until the time that he goes to the bed, which is about 16, 17 hours, he only gets to see his parents no more than 1 hour. No more than 1 hour. What does he end up seeing his parents for? What kind of talk, what kind of language that his parents talk to him? The father gets up in the early morning, go to work, does not come back until late night. At that time, the father is dead tired. He only needs to have his dinner and watch some program, some TV program, and then go to bed. Does not have enough time to talk to the children, nor the mother. The mother is also busy in her work, or if not work, then she's busy with, you know, with her friends, or cooking, or going out for shopping. If not of all of those, then thanks to the technology, using the iPads and iPhone, sending messages and, you know, talking to the friends and family, while the kid is left to his own destiny, left to his own way of upbringing. What is the difference between this kind of kid that does not have any emotional support? The father or the mother never talk to him, never tell him what is the moral way of doing things, the good way of doing things, and that orphan that he does not have father or mother from the beginning. The parents don't get to see their children. We have reduced the role of the parents to be only an ATM machine. Whenever the child wants money, we give the money. But afterward, we never check on him. We never see with whom he's talking, who are his friends, what kind of programs he watches on TV. When he goes out, where does he go? We are very careless about. We care less about those social issues that pertain to the child, to our child. Then when he grows up or when she grows up and then runs into trouble, then we say, wow, why God hates me so much that I ended up having such kind of children? It were us. It were me and my wife. We didn't pay attention. We never gave the proper raising for our children. You see, if I don't raise my child in the way that I want to, there are others who are happy to take care of this problem, to raise my child in the way that they want. The child has a vacuum in heart and in mind. That should be filled anyway. It's like an empty glass, an empty cup. This empty cup has to be filled. If it's not filled by a useful drink, a suitable drink, it will be filled up by air. So the soul of the child, the mind of the child, and the heart of the child eventually will be filled up. If I don't teach my children the proper way, the morality, the ethics, my own Islamic tradition, then Nickelodeon Channel will teach them. Then SpongeBob and American Idol will teach them. Then I will end up, you know, after many years, when my daughter reaches 13 and 14 and ask her to wear hijab and she doesn't, then I come to the Sayyid or I go and have some, you know, counseling why my daughter or my son are not listening to me. If I don't take care of the problem from, you know, early stages, if I don't tell her while she's 7 or 8 years old, if I don't talk to her about the importance of hijab, do I want her to have hijab by the age of 16? By the age of 16? No girl, you know, would like to wear hijab if she has not been introduced before that, long before that. At that time, I have nothing but accept one option, and that's to raise my hand in the dua and say, "Amman yujib," that my wife, that my daughter eventually wears a hijab. And the same thing goes with the son. So this poet come to say that the true orphan is not that one who has lost his parents. It's the one who lacks the emotional support. It is that support, that guidance, that upbring him. Anyone who lacks that, then that's in reality is considered to be an orphan. Based on this definition, brothers and sisters, 60 or 70% of our children are considered to be orphans, unfortunately. Now, when you examine the ahadith, the narrations of the Prophet, peace be upon him, or Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salam, you see again, they stress on the emotional need for the orphan. They don't talk about the biological support or the medical support. They talk mostly about this emotional kind of support. For example, Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam has this hadith. He says, "Ma min abdin yamsahu ala ra'si yateemin rifqan bihi illa a'taahu Allah bi kulli sha'ratin nooran yawm al-qiyamah." He said that anyone who just out of love, out of mercy, put his hand, tap his hand on the head of a yateem, of an orphan, out of mercy, God will give him on the hereafter, on the day of judgment, a strain of shining light for every single hair that his hand is passed on. You know, on the day of judgment, it's an absolute darkness, complete darkness. You cannot see anything around you, despite the fact that it is completely packed. People are suffocating due to the packedness. You know, we are packed with other humans. At the same time that we are packed, we cannot tell who's next to us, in this side or on that side. The only way that you can see it is through light. Light is provided by God in such kind of ways. You see, the Imam is stressing on this fact that show your emotional support. Show your tenderness, your love to the yatim, to the orphan. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, sallu alayhi bi'a'la aswatikum. He says that if the orphan cries, the throne, the majestic throne of God will be jolting, will be shaking. Now God would ask his angels, "Who has made this orphan cry?" The angels say, "You know better." Then God says this. He says, "فَإِنِّي أُشْهِدُكُمْ أَنَّ لِمَنْ أَسْكَتَهُ وَأَرْضَاهُ أَنْ أُرْضِيهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ." I am making you as a witness. God is telling the angels that you will be the witnesses that whoever will make this child quiet and satisfy him, I will make him satisfied on the hereafter, on the day of judgment. Again, another hadith. He says that إِذَا بَكَى الْيَتِيمُ وَقَعَدْ دُمُوعُهُ فِي كَفِ الرَّحْمَانِ, that when the orphan cries, those tears fall in the hands of God. You see, always emphasizing on the psychological, on the emotional need to support the child. Now, before we go further, I would like to show you some statistics, some numbers about the orphans. How many orphans right now in the world? What does the statistic say? And how is their conditions? And these statistics, these numbers have been taken from the UNICEF. You know, UNICEF is the United Nations organization for such kind of a humanitarian works. According to the UNICEF estimates, it says that the number of orphans worldwide right now is about 200 million. You know, we have become 7 billion people just recently, a few days ago or a couple weeks ago. The world population has become 7 billion. Out of those 7 billion, we have 200 million who are orphans. Meaning that on every single day, there are 5,700 orphans. Every single day, they become, meaning that 5,700 children become orphans. Now, every year, there are 2 million 100,000 orphan, 1,000 child that becomes orphan. Now, based on a proportions, meaning based on percentages, Africa has the highest percentage. 55 million, Africa has 55 million orphans, meaning that 12% of entire population. I'm sorry, 12% of all children in sub-Saharan Africa are considered to be orphans. Now, out of those orphans, 30% lose parents to the AIDS epidemic due to sickness of AIDS that is so, you know, an epidemic in Africa. 30% of those children who lose their parents is due to the, you know, due to AIDS. Now, only about 600,000 getting support by the orphanages. In Asia, there are 70 million of orphans, meaning the number is bigger, yet the proportion is smaller. 7.7 million of those orphans have become orphans in 2010 alone, meaning last year. 7.7 million. Only 270,000 orphans receive care by full-time orphanages. Now, if you want to talk about Islamic countries, we have two Islamic countries who have taken the highest proportion among all countries, Afghanistan and Iraq. In Iraq alone, there are 5 million orphans. 5 million orphans. Now, what is the population of Iraq? Population of Iraq is 30-some millions, about 32 million, meaning about 16% of the population of Iraq are orphans. 70% of those orphans, you know, have become orphans after the U.S. invasion of Iraq. Of course, this statistics is according to the Ministry of Labor and Social Affairs, and that was released in February of 2010. 16% of the entire population are considered to be orphans. If we want to talk in a proportion, meaning in percentages, imagine U.S. U.S. population is about 310, 320 million. 16% of 320 million, meaning 50 million. 50 million, you can fill those cities, the five largest cities in U.S., like New York, Los Angeles, Houston, Philadelphia, and Chicago. All of those five cities, still, they don't have 50 million of population. So you can fill five major cities in Iraq with those orphans, 5 million. Now, how many of those are receiving, you know, proper nourishment and protection? It does not say, but the report says that 600,000 are personally homeless. You know, they don't have a proper house to live in. Now, let's say that those numbers are exaggerated, too much. We have gone so much. Let's say even half of this number still, it is outrageous. It's a crime against those people that we have so many of those innocent lives that do not have adequate support. Now, how many orphanages worldwide? This statistic goes back to 2000. I could not get, you know, a more updated statistic than this one. It says that by year 2000, there were 11,911 orphanages. Brothers and sisters, this is the important point. My point is here, listen to this. There are 11,911, meaning 12,000, let's say 12,000 orphanages worldwide that take care of the orphan children. That was back in 2000. Obviously, this number has increased. How much? I don't know. I have no idea. But if we are talking again in proportions, it says that out of this 12,000, they are 8,250 orphanages that run by Catholic charities and institutions. Catholic charities and institutions. By the way, the number of orphans in Islamic countries after sub-Saharan come number two. So sub-Saharan countries in the sub-Saharan African countries, they take the number one based on percentages. Number two comes the Islamic countries. So you can understand that even some of those Catholic institutions and charities have run in for orphanages in the Islamic countries. They are raising our own children, despite the fact that God has talked about, you know, how to support the orphans. So much admonishment for the people to support the orphans. As the ayah says, فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. Those are those numbers. There are some other numbers. It says that in Russia and Ukraine, you know, in the previous Soviet Union republics, it says that 10 to 15% of those orphans who go to the orphanages, and when they come out, they commit suicide. Why? Because once they reach the age of maturity, the institution asks them to leave. The orphanages tell them, you need to go. So when they leave, they don't have any shelter. They don't have any place, nor they have received the proper education and training to stand up on their feet. Therefore, it says 10 to 15% of those orphans commit suicide. Look at to this number. It says that 60%, unfortunately, 60% of those orphans who happen to be girls are lured into indecent act once they step outside of the orphanages. 70% of the boys who are orphans, they become hardened criminals. Why? What is the problem? They have received, again, pay attention to this. They have received proper nourishment. In terms of medical and biological support, there is no problem. Again, where is the problem? It's the upraising. Because there was lack. They were deprived from receiving a good amount of appraising, emotional support. That's why the school of psychoanalysis of psychology that I talked about yesterday, you know, the school that Sigmund Freud have, you know, institutionalized, says that orphans and orphanage is considered to be detrimental to a child. Any child who happened to be an orphan, then that person is deprived. That person lacks big amount of support that he cannot compete with others. Why? Because one criteria for a person to become, you know, a good adult in society, a useful member in the society, is to be adjusted, to get the ability to adapt to the new situation. The problem with those orphans is that they have difficulty incorporate themselves, adapt themselves, and be able to compete with other kids. They have difficulty in adjusting. They cannot adjust to the new environment. They always lack. Once you have a population, a country that 10 to 15% of its population are orphans, who do not receive a proper education, who are not raised very well. And in spite of this, they have poverty, lack of adequate resources, lack of adequate food. What do you expect those orphans will become? They will become a nuclear bomb tomorrow. They will destroy the entire society. You take anything, you take those useful things from any individual, take his wealth, dignity, integrity, and education, and then let this member in the society, let this individual walk in the streets, in the market. Obviously, he will become a hardened criminal. Why? Because it was the society that cared less about him from the beginning. If we pay good amount of attention to him and support those kind of individuals, then we don't have that kind of problem later in society. Despite the fact that this school of psychology say that this is a detrimental thing for orphans. Yet, we can find exceptions, brothers and sisters. If you look around you, if you read history, you see that they were, you know, noted individuals, prominent individuals, who have reached the highest level, the highest positions, and gained fame and respect in every field, in every area, that happened to be orphans. For example, if you look at the list of you as a president, Herbert Hoover happened to be an orphan. Bill Clinton was an orphan. There are great personalities in history, like Aristotle was an orphan. Caesar was an orphan. They are a big list of people, individuals, great individuals, who happen to be orphans, meaning that they overcome their deficiency, their lack of support. In Islamic history, for example, we have many of our scholars who were orphans. Muhammad Baqir al-Sadr, Shaheed Muhammad Baqir al-Sadr, one of our contemporary great scholars in philosophy, in Islamic literature, was an orphan. Imam Khomeini was an orphan. There are many great leaders, personalities, if you look at their history, who were orphans, yet they were able to overcome the difficulty and achieve what they could achieve. Why? How come an orphan lacks the support of his parents, especially his father, could be able to compete with others, meet the challenges, and then overcome those challenges? Why? You see, brothers and sisters, again, as children, we have our parents, especially the father, as our role model. We consider him to be the role model, the exalted father. Whatever he does, that's considered to be perfect. His career, his actions, his style, to a child, that is perfect. Therefore, we try to emulate the father. We try to make him, set him as an example, and work our way to reach his status, to achieve his status. We consider him to be the standard. The parents becomes the standard. But such kind of orphan who has lost his parent, if this child does not receive the adequate amount of care, of course he loses the ambition. The ambition dies in him, and then he becomes a useless member in society. But let's say if you provide the care, the necessary care for him, he will set the example himself. He cannot find the role model, then he becomes the role model for himself. He becomes the standard of himself. Therefore, nothing would suffice him except being a perfect. Therefore, he works toward perfection. When you look at history, you see that the great prophets of God happen to be orphans as well. How many prophets we have? We have 124,000 prophets. Among them, 5 are considered to be the greatest. Ulul Azm. Out of those 5, Abraham was an orphan who has lost his father. God mentioned the name of Azar as Abih, father. But in reality, Azar was not his father. Rather, he was his uncle. Abraham alayhi salam was an orphan. Moses was an orphan. Again, in the Holy Quran, you don't see any mention of Moses' father. The father of Moses died while Moses was at very young age. Quran talks about his mother and his sister, but there is no mention of his father. Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, was born without a father. And finally, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, sallu alayhi wa ala aswatikum. The Prophet, peace be upon him, also was raised as an orphan who lost his father before he was born. And later on, he lost his mother. Is there any connection between a prophethood and orphanage? and being an orphan? Some scholars, they say yes. God has intentionally made this fact, especially for those four great prophets. You see, those four prophets are considered to be the greatest among all the prophets. They have reached the leadership position. As God tells his prophet Abraham, that you have reached the position of Imam. That's a great position of leadership, requires a full capacity of dealing with people. The prophet has to have the capacity to deal with every kind of people. Who are the followers of the prophets? The followers of the prophets, when you check, you see those followers are basically the poor, the have-nots, the working class, those who have been deprived, those who have been oppressed by the society. You see, when a prophet comes to a society, what does he do? He will change the status quo. He never sides with the aristocrats. He never sides with the ruling class. Why? Because if the ruling class were good, why would God send a prophet? When God sent a prophet to a society, meaning that there is something wrong with this society. There is something is not just. Who commits injustice? It's the ruling class. So when a prophet comes, the first thing that he does, he confronts the ruling class. Therefore, always the deprived, the lacking people, the working class who follow him. This is a point that the ruling class always make fun of the prophets. They tell Nuh, for example, he says that we know which kind of followers you have. وَمَا نَرَاكَ اتَّبَعَكَ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ هُمْ أَرَاذِلُنَا. Meaning that we don't see anyone respectable is following you. Only the meanest, only the immature are following you. This is a fact. Any prophet that when you look at, you see that he's followed by the masses who are deprived, who are, you know, poor. Now, how would you interact with such kind of masses? Shouldn't you have the ability to deal with them? Shouldn't you have a kind of heart that is able to deal with them, understand their passion and understand their problems and their aspirations? So once you become the head of a state or you come in a position of control, at that time you understand what they needed and you implement those solutions for them. Well, no one can do that except the person who has gone through the trouble, who have seen the pain himself. Therefore, a prophet that was lacked by a father who has gone through this difficulty, this hardship, can understand the agony very much. He can feel for those masses. Therefore, God has made it intentional for those prophets to be orphans, have the feeling for the orphans, can understand what is an orphan look like, how painful it is to be brought up, to meet the challenges in early life, and at that time he becomes a leader, that he can take the people to the right side. This is one reason. The other reason that the scholars say that those prophets were orphans is the fact that being an orphan is testimonial to their prophethood. Meaning it's a farther proof that they are prophets, that they are connected, directly connected to God. Meaning that they don't make up themselves. Not that they come and say that I am a prophet and you follow me. They are directly connected by a divine source. How come? How is it so? You see, brothers and sisters, when you look at an event, let's say you are observing an event, you have some ideas about that event, but eventually the result does not match the data, the idea that you had in. What is your conclusion? The conclusion that there is something wrong. I will give you a few examples. You see, you have a favorite team, for example, a national team of soccer. Okay, I don't know if you really like soccer or you like basketball. I'm not that familiar with football or basketball. I can talk about soccer. Imagine that in the next world championship, you have the world champion, Brazil or Germany, with their style of playing, with their team members, very able, very professional. They play with a rookie team. Name me a team. I don't want to mention Lebanon, neither Iraq. So let's pick a number, like pick a name, okay? Italy, no, Italy is bigger as well. Let's choose a country that, you know, does not have that a good team. Egypt, for example, okay? You take Brazil with a very shining, you know, history of winning the World Cups and winning the cup itself. Then on that day, you have all the idea. You know how the team plays. You know the other team as well. The other team is very rookie. They don't know how to play. But then after the match, someone comes to you and tell you that Brazil have lost 10-0. What is your conclusion? The conclusion is that did they really play or they were bribed? The first thing that comes in your mind that there is something wrong. There is an external factor, meaning something has contributed to this. They have been bribed by the other team. Otherwise, if they play well, they should win. Another example, you go to work. In the work, there is a custodian. There is a security guy. And you know the salary of this security guy. You know, this guy has a humble salary. He hardly can meet, you know, can meet the ends. It's so difficult for him to end up, you know, having little saving at the end of the month. One day you see that this security or this custodian is riding a Ferrari. And he tells you that I am the one who owns the Ferrari. What is the conclusion? Can he buy it through his salary? Obviously not. So either someone has donated this to him, or he has stole it from somewhere, or he won the lottery to buy this kind of car. There is no other explanations. Why? Because the data that you have, the observations that you have, the fact that he was a custodian, and the idea that you have about him would not make him able to buy such kind of a car. Okay? You have a child, let's say, 7 or 8 years old child. How much a child knows? Let's say he knows a few poetry. He can recite a few verses. He can speak eloquently. He knows little of math. But you see a child that he's 7 or 8 years old, all of a sudden he talks about Shakespeare and knows the entire novels of Shakespeare. He knows the very complicated algebraic problems and can solve them in a few minutes. What is your conclusion? That this kid is a supernatural. Why? Because at this age, 7 or 8 years old, no kid can provide or produce such kind of work. Therefore, this kid must have a supernatural ability. Now let's go to the prophets. Usually, who sends the kid to the school? It is the parents. So if the kid loses the parents, the first thing that he would lack is an education. He would not have a proper education. When you know that this kid was raised poor, he did not have education. He was illiterate. He did not even one day recite poetry. But all of a sudden, you see that this guy, when he matures, he started to talk about philosophy, for example. He started to talk about the future events. He started to talk about science. He started to talk about very comprehensive, very profound meaning issues. The conclusion that some extraordinary has happened. So when God has sent the prophets, and especially our prophet, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, who has been raised as an orphan and someone who did not read and write, and all of a sudden, this great prophet become knowledgeable, full of knowledge, then it was a testimonial that no one could help him. It was not the way, it was not a conventional way of learning, except it was a divine way. Therefore, the scholars say that the fact that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, the greater prophet, was an orphan is a testimonial that he was a true prophet. He had a direct connection with the divine source. Sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. In conclusion, brothers and sisters, what I needed to say here and what I need to say in advance is that we have to take a lesson from all what we have said tonight. Is that we as Muslims, as an Islamic society, we should care for those children. It is our prime responsibility. It is a responsibility of me as an individual, as a human being, and as a Muslim to support such kind of people, unfortunate children who have lost their parents. There are a few narrations that I would like to share it with you. One of them, they say that Isa alayhi salam, Prophet Jesus, one day he passed by a graveyard and he noticed that in one of those graves, the deceased, the one who was dead, was being punished. You know, and the punishment is completely different from the worldly punishment and the punishment that God will give us on the hereafter. So he have noticed that this deceased is getting severely punished. The next year when he comes back again and he passes by the same area, he see that this guy is resting fine. There is no punishment. He asked God, what has happened? The answer was, Ya Ruhallah. God is telling the Prophet, peace be upon him, إِنَّهُ أَدْرَكَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ صَالِحٌ. He had a small boy. That boy grew up. And then that boy who became righteous, فَأَصْلَحَ طَرِيقًا وَآوَى يَتِيمًا. That little boy has taken care of an orphan. When he took care of that orphan, that boy has taken care of that orphan, God has removed the punishment from his father in the graveyard. This is how the effect of taking care of an orphan will produce. You see the effect? The other hadith, the one that is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi has said, من كفل يتيما وكفل نفقته كنت أنا وهو في الجنة كهاتين. The Prophet has said, and he gestured with two of his fingers. He said that whoever financially support a child who happens to be an orphan, he would be in the same level as I am, like this. And he points with two of his fingers. You see how close this finger is to this finger? So close. This is how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi described the person who supports an orphan. There are many of those ahadith. At the same time that God admonishes people to support the orphans and the rewards that he will give them, at the same time he tells them of the punishment who incurs injustice against the orphan. In this ayah, it says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ الْيَتَامَى ظُلْمًا إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا. You see, those people who plunder, who ransack the wealth of an orphan, in fact, they are eating hellfire. Hellfire. This is not a food. This is not a money. In fact, it's a hellfire. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing. Is telling his prophet, I have given you everything. I have provided for you everything. Then I want you one thing. فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. Never humiliate a yatim, an orphan. Take care of an orphan. Never make an orphan cry. Never beat an orphan. Never make him never make him upset, especially if that orphan is a grandchild of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. You see, brothers and sisters, in the tragedy of Ashura, the family of Imam Hussein had many orphans. Imam Hussein, alayhi salam, left many children behind him who turned to be orphans. It is narrated that on the eve, on the night of Ashura, after the massacre of Imam Hussein, when the army of Ibn Ziyad, they rushed, they charged to the tents and the households of the Prophet, peace be upon him, when they took the family of Imam Hussein captive, at that time the soldiers came to Umar ibn Sa'd and told him, "Ya Amir, you have disconnected water, you deprived Hussein and his family from water. Now Hussein is dead. You killed Hussein. Let those orphans drink some water." He said, "Yes, give them the water." The soldiers, they bring the skins of water to feed those children. But none of those children came forward to take the water. When they would ask them, "Why don't you come and drink?" they would say, "How do we drink while the son of Rasulullah has passed away while he was thirsty?" None has dared to come and drink. Eventually, one yatim, one orphan came forward. She said, "I will take. Give me the bowl of water." When they poured the bowl of water, she ran away. She charged toward the battle front. Her aunt Zainab asked, "What is happening? Where are you going?" She said, "I'm going to the battle front to find my father Hussein, who died out of thirst, so I can give him some water." This is how were the orphans of Imam Hussein. And one of them was Fatima al-Alila. Fatima was paralyzed, was handicapped. Imam Hussein alayhi salam left her in Medina. He put her with Umm Salama, the wife of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and asked her to take care of her. Fatima did not want to stay. She came to Imam Hussein alayhi salam and begged him, "Oh father, let me come with you." But she was sick. She was paralyzed. The Imam could not take care of her. The Imam promised her, told her, "Once we are in Karbala and we sit in Karbala and we settle there in Iraq, then I will send either your brother Ali al-Akbar or your uncle al-Abbas to come and bring you safely to Iraq." At that moment, when the family of the Imam alayhi salam, they rode the camels and they were about to leave, all of a sudden Fatima have heard the caller saying, "Let's move." She comes out, she sees that the caravan is leaving, the group is leaving, but she could not walk. She throws herself on the ground. She started crawling until she got to her father, Imam Hussein. She kept crying and begging for the Imam to take her. The Imam held her in his chest, kissing her. She said, "Okay, please take me as a servant with you." The Imam said, "We cannot take you. We need to stay here." She said, "At least keep Ali al-Asghar, Abdullah al-Radi' among me. Keep him with me so I can take care of him." The Imam said, "No, he has to go. He has a role to play in Karbala. We cannot leave him with you." She said, "Okay, I have only one favor to ask you, father." "What is it?" She said, "Open your chest. I would imprint a kiss right on your neck." She kissed the Imam in his neck. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك وأناخت برحلك. عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين ورحمة الله وبركاته. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.